Hi folks, and welcome to Prep with a Pro week 17. Go and get a coffee or something because we have a shitload of stuff to get through. As you recall from last week, I did a carb front loading experiment. I'm going to do 2 weeks of some typical peak week carb loading protocols. And last week I started with a front loading protocol. Okay, this week I'll do a back loading protocol. Now, before we get into that, like I say, we have a shitload of stuff to get through. Now, you can probably see a lot of food on your screen right now. All of it absolutely delicious. The reason I've put this up here is because this week I had a very good question from a follower of mine who said to me, are pros 100% compliant with their diet? Now, as it transpired in the conversation with this person, they'd done a prep and they were now struggling with post-comp and feeling very guilty about eating bad foods. Now, as you know, I don't label foods good or bad. I've developed what's known as athlete thinking, where everything that I eat food is a tool that I use to achieve a specific purpose. Okay, which completely removes the emotion from what I do and allows me to see food for what it is. It allows me to assign purpose to food, even if it's not necessarily clean food. Then, you know, I usually have a reason for eating that particular food, even though it's not clean or not good or any of that sort of stuff. Let's just go into my diet. Now, over the course of the prep, You know I have not been 100% compliant. I had a whole week in South Africa with no gym and nowhere to prepare my own food, you know, and all these amazing buffets. Now, yes, I was probably about 85 to 90% compliant with what I normally do because fortunately there was an awful lot of salads, you know, and as you can see from these photos up in the top left-hand corner on the left-hand side, that is a pretty standard meal. In fact, I eat that during the week. Every day, I eat an enormous salad like this for my post-workout snack and my lunch. My afternoon snack is always some meat. And if I'm having carbs at the time, some sort of carbs, it's usually sweet potato or a piece of fruit. The rice cakes here is from the carb front load this week. My breakfast is always without fail either boiled eggs or chicken, and my dinner is always some kind of protein, whether it be whitefish, salmon, prawns, calamari, venison, beef, chicken, turkey, you know, whatever meat, and an enormous bowl of green soup made from 9 vegetables. That's what I eat during the week, and yes, during the week I am 100% compliant to that diet. There's no budging. I mean, I guess it makes it quite, I guess I'm quite lucky in the fact that I've got a 9-to-5 job. So it allows me, because I've got such a regular routine, it allows me to eat totally regularly. And the kind of foods that I eat, I always focus on maximizing my nutrition, as I've always said. I focus on making sure I get my micronutrients. I don't focus necessarily on the macros, although I know I've been showing you all of the macros. I don't do IFYM, and at some point I must have a rant about IFYM. What I'm concerned about is my overall calorie targets, and as I've been illustrating all the way through, it's not what you hit on a single meal or a single day, it's what you do over the course of a week and over the course of a prep that matters. Okay, that being said, as you can see, my weekday foods, extremely nutritious. Like, I've got in these salads, I've probably got anywhere between 10 and I said, you know, I have done up to about 21 or even 22 different sorts of foods. Now, when you're eating that many different sorts of foods, they're all extremely high in nutritional value, it means I've got all my nutritional bases covered. And because most of them are super nutritious, that a lot of them are actually very, very low in calories as well. This is how I can have such enormous plates of food, okay, even though I'm right at the pointy end of my prep, okay? So During the week, yes, absolutely no deviation on my diet whatsoever. During the weekend, let's flip over to the right-hand side of the screen. And you can see all of this lovely stuff over here. Now, as you know, on Instagram, or maybe you don't, and if you'd like to follow me on Instagram, I am the Brekkie Queen. Why? Because I love my breakfast. Now, on a comp prep, and this is something I guess that pros learn how to keep it real. And I've said this a number of times. When you're on comp prep, your life should not be consumed by comp prep. Now, if you're a novice, I do suggest that you follow your diet, 100%. I am not actually advocating that you completely fall off the wagon and completely fall off your diet. It's a learning process, okay? And as a pro, the more and more you compete, the more you learn, how to build in, I guess you could call it a safety net. I feel that those who bury themselves in a comp prep and become absolutely rigid about comp prep is like, and have blinkers on like this, it's like, no, I'm on comp prep, I can't eat this, and I can't go out with my friends, and I can't go to the wedding, and I can't have the birthday party, and I can't have that tiny little mini Easter egg, which is only 6 grams of chocolate, because that's it, my whole life would be ruined. If you get into that mindset, you're setting yourself up for failure. And I would argue that nobody, novice or whatever level you are, can ever be 100% compliant on a diet. And if you try and be 100% compliant on a diet, I feel you're setting yourself up for a big fall anyway. If you can get to 90 or 95%, perfect. You've got to have that wriggle room to allow a bit of sanity, and you've got to be able to give yourself a bit of a break. So pros really know how to keep it real. And these breakfasts, this is my reel, okay? Now, if you look at the foods, they're all really, apart from the ice cream and the peanut butter there, and maybe not the waffles there, but there's a lot of really, really super nutritious foods there. You've got kumari, you've got kale, egg, that's a poached egg. If you can't fit a poached egg into your comp diet, you're doing it wrong anyway, okay? Spinach, we've got wilted spinach. If you can't fit wilted spinach into your comp prep diet, you're doing it wrong, okay? Raw carrots, again, if you can't fit raw carrots into your comp prep diet, you're doing it wrong. Fresh fruit, again, any diet should be allowed fresh fruit in your diet, okay? So yes, these are sort of much higher calories and less ideal foods, but I know how to build it in, and this is how I keep it real and how I maintain my level of sanity during comp prep. As a pro, we've also learned basically how to go hard and when to pull it back, so we know, when to just, I guess, relax the reins a little bit and when to just sort of really hit it hard. So like I say, 5 days during the week, I'm absolutely rigid, no deviation. The weekends, I pull it back a bit just to give myself a little bit of a breather. And in doing so, by eating these foods, I am giving myself permission to eat these foods. I never, ever have the issue where I go, oh my God, I fell off, I didn't comply with my comp diet. Oh my God, my life has ended. That's it, I'm an awful person. I don't get that guilt complex, okay? I give myself permission. I choose foods generally that still maximize my nutrition, and therefore I allow it in my diet. Again, the more you compete, the more you actually learn how to recover and manage. Should you have an absolute binge, the more you compete, you learn how to manage that. And I've given you a really good example of that with the anabolic fast, post binge, if you like. When I had that day when I went off diet. It was a deliberate choice, but then I pulled it back the next day with an anabolic fast. And actually, I've got a very good example to go through with you this week of that as well. I've already alluded to the fact that, the more you learn about food and how it affects your body, the more that you can get into this athlete thinking. And I do encourage you to learn, really, really study yourself and watch how foods affect you so that you can learn how to manage and mitigate when you do have binges without giving yourself the hard time beating yourself up, okay? So I just wanted to go through that because, It was a very, very good question, and I feel it needed explaining further. So in answer to the question, are pros 100% compliant? No, I would seriously doubt that we are. Yes, we're about 90 to 95% compliant, but we know how to keep it real, okay? What happened last week? Now, as you recall, last week, I was catching up with a very good friend, and we were going to have a very lovely bottle of wine, and I said to you that I'd planned it in, I'd built it in, and I'd allowed for it. I was going to do the anabolic fast on Monday to mitigate the extra calories, and I showed you all of the charts and numbers, and here's what my weekly average would have been. And yes, it's probably about 150 above what's my current average, but I knew how to mitigate it this week, and I had the plan for that. Now, what actually happened? Well, this happened, and we'll go to the next chart. You see, that one there was what I planned we were going to eat with the wine. This is what actually happened with what we did with the wine. Okay, and I'll say what happened next. So here we go again. This is what I had planned that we were going to eat, and this is what actually happened. So what did actually happen? Well, although we'd kind of planned what we were going to eat, we actually hadn't planned who was going to do the cooking. So I thought he was doing the cooking and he thought I was doing the cooking, and it turned out that neither of us had bought the food. So there was going to be no cooking. So we thought, oh, bugger it, we'll order a pizza. So we had one pizza. And then we're like, nah, still hungry. So we had another pizza. So that's one pizza each. And the one thing I had bought, because we always do this, is I'd bought a lovely like tub of dairy-free ice cream, salted caramel dairy-free ice cream with some nice berries and full-fat cream. So we had the whole tub of the ice cream with berries and the full-fat cream. It turned into a bit of a blowout. Now, like I say, that wasn't definitely not ideal. And as I said, I was already going to do the anabolic fast on the Monday anyway, just to mitigate what we planned. So it was even more necessary on Monday to do the anabolic fast. And this is what happened. I got on the scales on Monday and I was at 58 kilos. Oh my God, I almost had heart failure. Now, you remember that my lowest weight last week, I was down at 54.9. So that one meal, those 3,400 calories, I put on 3 kilos of weight. Now, and you could see how bloated I was looking the next day. Now, was this fat? Of course not. You all know the numbers that 3,500 calories is a kilogram of fat. Well, okay, I ate 3,400 calories over the course of the day. That's not a kilogram of fat. If you subtract whatever my resting metabolic rate of about 1,500 is off that, then yes, I ate in excess of 1,500 calories. So there's not a chance in hell I've put on 3 kilograms of fat. It's all water. So although that wasn't ideal, then on Tuesday I did do the anabolic fast on Monday, and then on Tuesday I went into the carb front load. So as you recall, Tuesday I did two and a half times my normal carbs. And you can see that just overnight again, I dropped 1.5 kilos of water weight, and I was just looking significantly better. But look, my legs are a little bit watery still. Okay, then Wednesday, I dropped a little bit more, not much. My legs have come in a little bit further, even though I'd had 2.5 times my carbs. I was still looking nice and lean, but I'm still looking a bit thick through the middle still. Okay, by Thursday, I was down to 1.5 my usual amount of carbs, and you know, I'm starting to shred up nicely, looking a little bit thinner, and the weight finally dropped off. So another thing I learned really is it takes 3 days for pizza and alcohol to work its way through my system. So that was a really good learning anyway. And this is what I'm saying on comp prep. Always be learning, okay? So now I know a massive pizza with half a tub of ice cream and berries and a bottle of wine will take 3 days to work through my system. So this is really good information to know. So definitely won't be doing that in the UK. Okay, Friday, I dropped again. Legs are starting to look a lot harder and I'm starting to look a little leaner through the middle. So I'm down on Friday. I was on my normal level of carbs. And then yesterday, legs have come in nicely. I'm looking nice and lean. So, and now, let's explain this weight here. I got on the scales and here's what's, you can see that I'm noticeably leaner through the middle, and I will do a comparison with all of them. So I'm noticeably leaner through the middle. But here's the thing. Although I was at the lightest on the scales, now I couldn't zero the scales and they were registering 1.5 kilos down. So if I add that 1.5 kilos on to what the scale weight shows, I'm actually at 54.7. Now, that's interesting because that means I've actually dropped again from last week. So although I had that blowout on Sunday and I did a full carb load, now with the carb load, all I did was increase the carbs and I dropped the protein. I didn't change the calorie level. I just flipped my protein and carb macros. That's all I did, okay? And you can see over the course of the week, I have come in beautifully, nice and gently, and I'm definitely leaner. Now, I was expecting my weight on Saturday to actually go up. And the reason being is because for some reason on Friday, I had a massive allergic reaction. I had chili scrambled for breakfast, and chili is in the nightshade family along with capsicums, tomatoes, white potatoes and eggplants, and I'm very, very allergic to nightshades, particularly capsicums. Now, like I say, the other week when my housemate had just been chopping them and I walked into the room, it started me off sneezing. And you can see that this is on Saturday, so this is on Friday night, which was probably about 10 hours after I'd eaten the chilies, my eyes really started puffing up and getting itchy. And then you can see on Saturday, I was still really puffy. And here's the thing, although my weight had dropped to the lowest for the whole week, and yes, I was looking nice and lean, I've got this kind of feeling where there's no other way of explaining it. When I hit my lowest weight on the scale for the week, I just feel kind of hollow. That's the only word I can use to explain it. For the last 3 or 4 weeks, I've been taking my weekly photographs when I've had this hollow feeling, because that's when I'm the leanest through the middle. Now, this week with carb load, and possibly because of this allergic reaction, I just haven't felt hollow. And I still think that I look a little bit puffy through the middle here. So did the carb load work? Well, it actually did. I mean, you can see there's a really nice progression downwards on the scale. So even though I've loaded the carbs, that was the Friday. So that could be information, I suppose, almost. But you can see from being really, really soft throughout the course of the week, you can actually see here my stomach is actually coming in a lot better. And that, of course, is, you know, and that's what you want to achieve. I'm actually just going to cut across to a video, because what you want to achieve is from here, having come in and hardened up nicely, you then on the stage day, so this Saturday would have been competition day, you then should only need to do a moderate carb up before you get on stage to look as vascular as possible. Now, I'm just going to pause it here and I'm going to cut over to another video. Now, this video here was taken on Saturday afternoon, and you can see that I'm looking ridiculously veiny. And I noticed on Friday afternoon also, I mean, it was actually quite warm at work, and on Friday afternoon, I noticed I was really starting to roadmap. And then again on Saturday, I just cycled home from posing, so I was quite warm. And it hasn't really come through here very well, but you can see how my veins are all absolutely popped out on the surface. And of course, this, certainly for figure and bodybuilding, this is exactly what you want to happen just before you hop on stage. So I have to say that even though I didn't have that nice hollow feeling that I like to have when I step on stage, from a vascularity perspective, I have to say that the carb front load actually has worked, because you can see I'm just looking, veins all over the place. So a moderate carb up on the day with just some sort of lollies and stuff would have had me looking absolutely perfect, I think. Okay, so let's carry on. So you can see from these progress pictures that I have come in nicely during the week, and it does look like the carb loading, the front loading protocol has worked and achieved its main aim, which is to fill me full of carbs so that by the time I get on stage, I just do a moderate carb up and it pops out all my veins. So I'm quite happy with that. I'm actually very interested to see that happening. So this week, of course, I'll move on to the carb backloading. Sorry, excuse me. Now, with carb backloading, there's actually a number of, I looked into it, and there's a number of protocols that you can do. And of course, they're all varied. And most of them are designed to help endurance athletes. There aren't so many carb backloading or sort of studies that I could come across to do with bodybuilders. And actually, there's another theory that carb front loading or back loading, in fact, carb loading in general, doesn't necessarily work as well for women as it does for guys. But there haven't been a bucket load of studies done really on women specifically, and particularly not female bodybuilders in the lead up to a show. So the data on it's very, very poor. But there are a number of carb back loading protocols. So I'll just go through those now. Now, a standard one would be, say, a 3 or 4 day glycogen deplete, followed by 3 days of carb loading. And there's a very detailed study here that came up with 0.43 grams per kilogram per hour of carbs. Now, if I did that at 54 kilograms of body weight, I would need to consume 557 grams of carbs in a day. Now, even with my carb front load, at 2.5 times my usual one, I only had 150 grams. So this is an absolute bucket load of carbs for me. And if I spread it over 7 meals, that's 79.5 grams of carbs a meal, or a total of 1,600 grams over 3 days. Now that's a ton of carbs. You know, I don't even eat that much off season over a whole week. Maybe I do need to start doing that. Anyway, by the by. So then there's another protocol which involves a carb load over just 24 hours. And essentially you eat your normal diet for the whole of the week, and then the day before your competition, or in this case, this is another endurance athlete one, the day before your race, you do, instead of your normal training, is you do a short HIIT workout, and by short, this was 3 minutes, okay? And then you carb load 12 grams per kilogram body weight. So if I did this, I could eat all normally during the week. I could, on Friday, I would then do my usual HIIT, and then I would load at 12 grams per kilogram of body weight, which would give me a total of 648 grams of carbs over the sort of following 24 hours. Which again is a shitload of carbs, 92.5 grams per meal, which is even more than the previous one. This one here is an endurance athlete one, and you follow your normal diet until 3 days out. And this assumes that you can tell it's an endurance athlete one because they're on about 55 to 60% carbs. Now, there's probably very few bodybuilders in the week before competition who are on that many carbs, but the principle is kind of the same. You follow your normal diet until 3 days out, and then you load up at 70% grams of carbs for 3 days. Now, for me, 70% of what carbs on my current diet would give me 280 grams of carbs a day, which sounds much more reasonable to me and much more doable. And that's about 5 grams of carbs per kilogram. Now, spread over 6 meals, don't know why I've done it over 6 meals there, that would give me 47 grams of carbs per meal. Now, if it was over 7, it would probably come down to about 42. Now, to me, that sounds a much more reasonable amount. So I could do a 3-day deplete, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Actually, no, I couldn't really. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, then I'd have to do Thursday and Friday, because then I'd have to do Saturday. I suppose I could do a 3-day deplete, then a 3-day load, and see what I look like on Sunday. So I could do this one. ISSN, in my book in the ISSN, they suggest a 24-hour one as well at 10 kilograms per kilogram of body weight. Now, for me, this would give me 540 grams of carbs spread over 7 meals, gives me 77 grams of carbs a meal. Now, and the way they're very specific that you need to have something immediately post-workout, and they recommend some sort of very high GI fruit juice with a bit of protein, and then every 2 hours after that, you have this amount of carbs. So this is why I've said 7 meals, because usually my meals are spread 3 hours rather than 2. So look, I could do this. I could follow my usual diet till Thursday or even Friday, and then do the carb load on Friday. What I'd probably do would be Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday on my usual diet, which, as you know, is extremely low carb. So that's kind of carb depleting anyway. And then Thursday is my refeed day, so I'd probably do it on Thursday. Then there's another one, the IAPC, which is 48 hours. And again, they suggest that you do, well, actually, they go into quite a lot of detail. And they say the first 24 hours is the critical period to get this sort of glycogen supercompensation. And then the second 24 hours, you kind of leave off if you want to. So they suggest you do a full body workout, especially with sprint training, because that's when you can really, really deplete yourself of glycogen and you'll get this super compensation effect. Then on your loading day, your first 24 hours of the loading day, you have a small carb meal 1 to 2 hours pre-training. Immediately post-workout, you have 1.5 grams per kilogram of lean body mass in a liquid, and they do suggest some protein with it. So this would be your post-workout shake. I kind of like the idea of this one, because this is lean body mass as opposed to body weight. Now, my lean body mass is probably about 48 kilograms of muscle, and my body weight is about 54 kilograms. So I kind of like this one because it's based on my lean body mass. In my immediate post-workout drink, I would need 72 grams of carbs. Then every 2 hours afterwards, and you're seeing a common theme here, it seems to be every 2 hours. So something immediately post-workout, then something every 2 hours. You load up at 8 to 10 grams per kilogram of lean body mass. Now, being female, potentially carb loading doesn't work so well for females. It's probably a good idea to err on the side of caution with this one. So I would go for the 8 grams per kilograms of lean body mass, so 848, which will give me 384 grams of carbs every 2 hours. So over 7 meals, that would give me 54 grams of carbs per meal for the first 24 hours. And then the second 24, and this, sorry, the first 24 hours is generally high GI carbs. Then the second 24 hours, you switch to low GI carbs at 5 grams per kilogram of lean body mass. So that would give me 240 gram carbs for the next day. So what I could do here is I could do, if I followed this one, I would do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday on my usual diet. Thursday, I would switch to the high GI load, so 54 grams of carbs per meal for 7 meals. And then Friday, I would drop it back to lower GI carbs at 34 grams of carbs per meal. So the two that I'm just kind of leaning towards is this 24-hour one. And again, being female, I'd probably err on the side of caution and go for the smaller one. So I'd probably choose this one here with the 10 grams. Or I could do the 48-hour ones, which just spreads it out a little bit more. So I'll make a decision sort of during the day. But basically, whichever one I'm going to follow, Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday are going to be my normal diet. And then I'll switch into the backload and see how I go. So that's the protocol for this week. Now then, with all of this going on, I told you there was a lot to this. Where did I end up? Bang on track for my average for the week. Happy with that. There's the anabolic fast. I said I was going to do an anabolic fast, and that's the anabolic fast, okay? Relatively consistent for the rest of the week. And then I did have a clean refeed. In fact, yesterday I did have a clean refeed, okay? And then today I've kept it nice and clean as well. So how does that look? This is the carb. Here you can see the carb front load. So 2.5 times, 2 times, 1.5 times, back to normal on Friday. Then I took all the photographs on Saturday, and then I had my refeed, which, like I say, was a clean refeed. So you can see this nice progression downwards of the carb front loading. And you saw how that brought me in nicely. So how am I looking? Well, I actually put a tan on and got into the bikini for the first time. And, God, I look like a bulldog licking a piss off a thistle is what my brother would say. But what I'm really happy about is my legs are starting to harden up. So I'm really pleased with that. And this is what I mean here. You can see I'm still looking thick through the middle. Compared to last week, I've got my lovely obliques. Last week, I was just feeling hollow. I had this hollow feeling. So although from the front, I probably look a little, in fact, I do look better. You know, my abs have just gone flat and I'm just looking a little puffier through the middle, which, you know, I hope it'd be interesting to see if the back load does the same thing. But I do actually have striations on my bum, which is great. So looking from the back, my glutes are looking really good, but I can still take a little bit off my hamstrings. So I'm actually, the next couple of weeks, I'm really going to push it hard. But, you know, I'm really happy with how I'm looking. My glutes are looking way better this year. Yeah, my glutes are just looking so good this year. I'm really pleased with that. We've worked very, very hard on those. God, I wish I could get a decent bloody photograph. It's doing my head in. See my glute ham tie in there. Triceps. Yeah, look, I've got some nice striations there. Nice definition there. Apart from the terrible photograph. Nice striations there. Yeah, chest is popping. My hamstrings are popping. Even my calf's got definition, which I'm stoked at. Yeah, legs are looking great. Look at these. Yeah, I'm really happy with this. Even my biceps are looking good this year. To the numbers. Where am I sitting? What are the numbers looking like? Well, with that big blowout on Monday, it's really skewed the weekly average. And it looks like I'm nearly 2 kilograms off where I should be. But my lowest point for the week is actually bang on track, which I'm stoked with. So this week and next week, I'm really going to bust a gut because I want to come in at the 54. And I think 54, I'm just going to be looking absolutely amazing. So a lot of hard work this week. How does that look on the old chart? Well, this is just a bit all over the place, like I say, because of that silly thing on Monday. But I have lost a wee bit overall. So look, progress is still on track. Keep it clean this week. Really bust it hard. And see how we're looking, see how the carb backload goes. Anyway, so look, I hope that's been informative. I know it's been a lot. We'll do the carb backload and report in next week. So have a good week. Enjoy Mother's Day for those of you who are mothers. And I will talk to you soon. Okay, take care. Bye.